Vyaasa and Suka. Vyaasa was the son of Parasara Maharishi and Satyavati Devi. Satyavati was the daughter of Uparichara Vasu and was also called as Vasavi. Vyaasa was therefore called as Parasarya and also as Satyavateya. Vyaasa was a Maharishi and Trikalajna, one who could know the past, present and the future. He foresaw that man was going to degenerate and become weak intellectually and physically. For the sake of the future generations, Vyaasa collected all the knowledge called the Veda as it was in the beginning and edited it into four Vedas called Rig, Yajur, Sama and Atharvana Vedas. He also wrote the Puranas. The Puranas are 18 in number. They are Brahma Purana, Padma, Vishnu, Shiva, Bhagavata, Bhavishyatuttara, Narada, Markandeya, Bhagneya, Brahma, Kaivartaka, Linga, Varaha, Skanda, Vamana, Kurma, Matsya, Brahmanda and Garuda Purana. He also wrote the Mahabharata for the benefit of those who could not study the Vedas or the Puranas, and it was called the fifth Veda. Even though Vyaasa had completed writing the Mahabharata for the benefit of the masses, he felt a great dejection, a state of unhappiness, want of peace in himself. He felt that somehow he had not pleased his Antaratman. He felt that he had wasted his lifetime. At that moment, Narada came by his side and inquired about his state of dejection. Vyaasa requested Narada to show him the way out of his gloom. Narada explained to him that singing the praise of the Lord and describing his stories would cure his disease. He advised Vyaasa to praise the Leelas of the Lord with all his heart. By doing so, he would be immensely benefited, as well as the ignorant would also be blessed by hearing the same. This shows that all the labor of Vyaasa till then had been a purely intellectual endeavor and that he never experienced what his intellect had dictated. His efforts had been partial and could not absolve him from the pairs of opposites, that is, joy and sorrow, success and failure, praise and abuse. So he was experiencing dejection. According to the advice of Narada, Vyaasa decided to write the Bhagavata Purana with his heart full of love for the Lord. He accomplished his work so well that the Bhagavata is full of praise of the Lord. It describes the various manifestations that he was pleased to adopt. It contains the essence of the Vedas and Upanishads. It explains the Gayatri Mantra, Satyam Param Dhimahi. The study or the hearing of the Bhagavata is the easiest way for liberation. Liberation from the bondage caused by ignorance. It bestows both knowledge and bhakti and leads to self-realization. Vyaasa taught the Bhagavata to his son Suka. Suka narrated the whole of the Bhagavata to Raja Parikshit on the banks of the sacred river Ganges at a time when death was hanging over the head of the king. Suka's arrival there was providential. He narrated the Purana in the presence of many sages, Satpurushas and Mahatmas. His narration was not only for the sake of those that were assembled there, but for posterity. Parikshit listened to the same with single-pointed concentration and reaped the full fruit of it. Suka was the son of Vyaasa. He was known also as Sukadeva, Suka Brahma and Suka Maharishi. Suka means a parrot. His figure was so beautiful and his voice so sweet that his name was quite appropriate to him. By birth, Suka was a perfect jnani. He was ever living in Brahman. He could see, hear, feel, taste and smell nothing but the Lord everywhere. He lived always in isolation. He had full knowledge of what Maya was and was fully conversant with the Lord, who was the Maya Prabhu. It was difficult for others to know him fully. He would behave like an illiterate, like a lunatic, like a dumb man and like an idiot. He never knew what grief was. He never cared to cover his body. He roamed about naked. To him, the body was apparent. He always saw him, the indweller of the body. The places which he visited became places of pilgrimage for others. Once, while he was roaming about, he chanced to pass by the side of a lake wherein many celestial damsels were bathing and playing about in the waters without any bathing costumes. They saw him pass by them, but they never felt any repugnance by his appearance. He passed on and did not notice the scene. But behind him came his father Vyasa, shouting for Suka, lest that poor boy should encounter any danger. He was after Suka to trace him and bring him back home. On the way, he saw the same celestial damsels bathing. But no sooner they saw him than they began to cover themselves up in haste. The old man could not go without noticing the scene. He forgot his search for his son and asked them about their strange behavior. "You saw my son passing by, a full-grown youth, completely naked. You never felt any compunction but remained naked. I am fully dressed and I am an old man. You choose to dress up in haste. Why this differential behavior in you?" he asked. They coolly replied, "Your son knows no male or female. Even if he sees a female, he does not feel any disturbance in his tranquility. There is an ocean of difference between you and your son." Vyasa, seeing that his son was behaving like an illiterate, once wanted that he should be educated. Out of attachment, he felt diffident to teach him himself. He asked Suka to go to King Janaka and get properly tutored. Janaka was considered as a Raja Rishi. In no time, Suka reached the royal palace and remained in the courtyard for 6 months. He made no requests. Janaka, though he knew of his arrival, never called him in. After 6 months, Janaka called him in and inquired. The youth narrated his father's command. Then Janaka prescribed him a test. He had to carry on his head a pan full of oil and follow a royal procession of dance and gala and return to the palace without spilling the oil. If he spilled the oil, his head would be served off. Suka agreed. The oil was placed on his head and the procession started and continued till late in the night and returned to the palace. Suka stood at the gate and the oil was removed off his head. Then Janaka asked Suka to describe the wondrous procession. Suka said that he saw no procession or dance nor gala. He was conscious of the oil on his head. He had finished his job as prescribed by the guru. Janaka found there was more for him to learn from Suka than anything to teach him. This Suka Brahma, having learnt the whole of Bhagavata Purana from his father, narrated it to Parikshit when that king was at the threshold of death. He would not stop in any one place for more than half an hour. But here he stayed on for 6 days and nights because his wanderings physically were only the silent communion with the Lord. That communion he could feel as he went on narrating the holy scripture for the benefit of one like Parikshit, who had relinquished everything at a moment's notice and for the sake of the Satpurushas that assembled in that holy place. It's easy to acquire wealth, relations and kingdom, but it is only the fortune rare few who could relinquish in a moment what they possessed as theirs for a lifetime. Greatness does not lie in acquisition, but only in renunciation. Tyage naika amritatva manashuhu. It is only out of renunciation that the supreme state is obtained. Parikshit developed renunciation from fear of death, but Suka was a personification of renunciation.